Hi, it's me, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut. It's fall of 2018, and you know what time fall is? It's BFR time. That's when Elon Musk is gonna update us all about SpaceX's plans to going to Mars with their big Falcon rocket. Now, last year, they changed quite a few things on us, so this year, we're gonna find out what's new here at SpaceX headquarters. I'm gonna go inside, I'm gonna learn and listen with my ears, and then we're gonna come outside, I'm gonna tell you all about what changed and all the big details and speculate on all the other fun things. So, let's get in there, let's learn some stuff. We are inside SpaceX's headquarters. This is where they actually manufacture the Falcon 9 rocket. And notice behind me is an actual Falcon 9 that's being worked on. And there's another one over there, but here's the crazy thing. Look at how much bigger the BFR is going to be. That is insane. And there's a reason why they have to build these things out on the port, because they wouldn't be able to get that thing out this door. So yeah, I can't wait for these details. Elon's gonna be talking in about 10 minutes. I better get going. We have so much to talk about. Okay, I'm here in the Tomorrow Studios to talk about what we just learned. The presentation wasn't as technical as I had hoped for. I really like all those nitty-gritty details. However, it was incredibly inspiring, especially the opportunity that Japanese billionaire Yusaku Maezawa is offering to artists. Okay, that actually made me tear up. So we could talk about that, or you know, we could sit here and we could talk about cool things like the new reentry system and how the fins need to actuate in order to basically belly flop through the atmosphere. Or we could talk about why does this stuff keep changing every single year and talk about kind of that evolution process. So I think that's what we're going to do today. And then in future videos, I'll get into some of those other things as well because they are really cool. Okay, first of all, let's go ahead and pop up all three versions of the BFR as we know it now. Now, don't forget, in 2016, they didn't really call it BFR publicly. It was called the Interplanetary Transportation System, or ITS. So I might call it that sometimes, but I might also just call it BFR. As you can tell, it's changed every single time they make an announcement. It used to be 122 meters tall. Then last year, it shrank down to 106 meters tall. And now this year, it's standing at 118 meters tall. Now, just for funsies, let's go ahead and compare that to the Saturn V, which was 110 meters tall, and the Falcon Heavy, which is 70 meters tall. Okay, then there's the width. It started off at 12 meters wide, then last year it shrank down to 9 meters wide, which it still is today, except for those folding landing legs slash fins that stick out a little bit more on the BFS. We'll talk about that more in a second. But of course, it is still a little bit skinnier than the Saturn V, which was 10 meters wide, and it's a lot wider than the current Falcon Heavy cores or the Falcon 9 core, which are 3.7 meters wide. One thing that we don't know too much more about is actually how many engines will be on the booster. So in 2016, it had 42 Raptor engines, and then when it shrunk down last year, it ended up with 31 engines. And since the diameter is the same, I'm guessing it'll still have 31 Raptor engines. But that's quite a few more than the Saturn V, which had 5 F1 engines. But it's not that much more from Falcon Heavy, which has 27 Merlin engines. Assuming there's the same number of Raptor engines on the booster, 31. Now Elon said each engine is capable of 200 tons of thrust, which is equal to 1,962 kilonewtons times the 31 engines. And that means it'll have 60.8 meganewtons of thrust. Now that's up from last year's 52.7 meganewtons, but that's still way down compared to the original aspirations of 128 meganewtons of the 2016 ITS. But then again, it's a lot more powerful than the Saturn V that had 35 meganewtons of thrust, and it's about 2.5 times more powerful than the Falcon Heavy. That's insane. So now, payload capability. This has changed a lot over the years. Initially, ITS was capable of 300 tons to low Earth orbit. That changed last year down to 150 tons. And now we're at 100 tons. So, you know, it's shrinking, but at the same time, 100 tons is still an insane amount, especially when you're talking about fully reusing a rocket. Now, of course, the Saturn V was capable of 135 tons to low Earth orbit, but that entire vehicle was expendable. Then you have things like the Falcon Heavy, which is 90% reusable, and in that configuration, it can only take about 30 tons to low Earth orbit. So it's a lot more capable than the Falcon Heavy. So now we need to talk more about the BFS, the Big Falcon Ship, or the upper stage portion. This again has changed a lot. This probably changed the most, and Elon's talked over and over again about how this is going to take the most design work and the most engineering because it has to tackle a lot of problems. Okay, so easily the most obvious addition is the fins. Now, I need to be really clear about these. These are not wings. They aren't there to provide lift. They're more there to provide drag and increase the surface area. So think about these more like flaps or air brakes and less like wings. Elon mentioned that this thing re-enters more like a skydiver does than an airplane does. And it does this by changing the amount of drag basically on those flaps in order to provide control authority. So this is really important because you actually want to bleed off as much speed as humanly possible through the atmosphere, and this is a really, really good way of doing that. This is super different from the Falcon 9, which re-enters butt first. And it's only going about a quarter of the speed of orbital velocity. And despite this, it still needs to do a really healthy re-entry burn, slowing itself down about half before it re-enters the atmosphere so the atmosphere doesn't destroy it. Now the BFS isn't going to try to lower its speed to 1/8 using retrothrust. That would be an insane amount of delta V and fuel wasted. So instead, it wants to use that atmosphere to its advantage because the atmosphere can remove almost all of the velocity of the vehicle. The trick is you want the atmosphere to do as much work as possible without destroying the vehicle. We'll go way more in depth with this crazy re-entry system because it's completely unique in the aerospace industry. I've never seen anything like this. Meanwhile, check out my video titled, Will the Falcon 9 be reusable or just refurbishable? Which goes into some of the physics of re-entry and talks about why you can't really compare a booster to an upper stage or spaceship. Okay, now back to the BFS and those fins real quick. Now, those fins are also the landing legs, which is important because they're going to have the dry mass of landing legs anyway. That's going to take away from some of the payload capability. But the thing is, you might as well make it so they do other things. A lot of people talk about when the Falcon 9 re-enters, why don't they use the landing legs to pop out and kind of work as air brakes? Well, that's basically what this is doing. It's using the landing legs as air brakes. So it's almost like bonuses instead of some kind of detractor. The engines on the BFS has changed all the time. Initially in 2016, we saw 6 vacuum-optimized Raptor engines and 3 sea-level engines. Then last year, it changed to 4 vacuum-optimized engines and 2 sea-level. And then Elon updated it like 3 weeks later on Reddit saying it's actually 3 sea-level engines. And now out of nowhere, we see 7 sea-level engines. What is the deal? Well, someone out there had enough nerve to ask Elon Musk what is up with this new design.
Hey Elon, Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut here. I see that you changed the engine configuration for the BFS. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, is there still engine out capability? You know, is it vacuum optimized but still landable on sea level? Can they function as an abort system? Can you just kind of tell us about your new decision making on that?
Oh yeah, actually you noticed that, that's a good thing to notice. Good eye.
Ah, shucks, did you hear that? Someone has a good eye. But as someone with different colored eyes, now I'm self-conscious about which one's the good one. Okay, but this new sea-level only configuration is pretty confusing to me. Last year, Elon talked over and over about how important it is to have engine out capabilities for landing to minimize pucker factor. This new configuration doesn't seem to be too privy on engine out capabilities for landing. Or does it? So now if you look closely, the engines are really, really close to the center, which is actually really good for landing burns, because Elon did say they're still planning to use 3 engines to land. Now say the outer engine would go out in the middle of a landing. I think they're close enough to the center that you could offset thrust by gimbling enough to actually make it so the vehicle doesn't totally, you know, tip over. So I believe it could probably still land on just 1 engine, but they'll light 3 for redundancy purposes. For now, we're not going to see a vacuum-optimized Raptor engine. And that's pretty weird, but honestly, it's because they can now streamline manufacturing and just crank out one engine over and over. But also because, quite frankly, it might be good enough with just sea-level engines. The specific impulse of the sea-level engine, or how efficient the engine is about 330 seconds. Now that's pretty good, but it's not as good as 380 seconds that they'd be able to get out of vacuum-optimized Raptor engines, which they could sport on later versions. And they might be able to just kind of change out which type of ship they use depending on the mission needs. Now, some of the nerdy details of the Raptor engine is it's a full-flow staged combustion engine that burns methane and liquid oxygen and has a crazy high chamber pressure of 300 bar. Let's not go into the details about what chamber pressure is right now, but just to compare how insane 300 bar is, let's look at some other engines. I believe the current king of high chamber pressure is the RD-180 from Russia, which is 265 bar. Then we look at the chamber pressure of the RD-170 that Russia used on their Energia rocket. That was 250 bar. The RS-25 main engine on the space shuttle was 206 bar. The SpaceX's Merlin engines that they currently use are 97 bar. And the F-1 engine on the Saturn V was only 70 bar. So 300 bar is crazy. The last big change is the internal cargo volume of the BFS. Now last year, I believe it was sporting 800 cubic meters, and now they're looking at over 1,000 cubic meters of cargo volume. This is interesting. Maybe the team decided that they'd rather have more internal cargo volume than actual payload mass capability. Just one of those trade-offs that might be valuable, you know, when you're flying humans who require a lot of moving room compared to just satellites. Another thing they added was aft cargo. What's aft cargo? Well, it's unpressurized portions of the ship, kind of like the trunk from the Dragon capsule. And why would you want this? Well, think about it. If you land on another planetary body and you need to get things like solar panels, you need to get fuel pumps to make new fuel out of the atmosphere using in-situ resource utilization, or maybe you need a rover. It's a lot easier if you just have to reach up from the bottom and put it on the ground as opposed to, say, having a cargo bay up top and unloading it using cranes or something. It's actually a pretty good idea. This is where having those smaller sea-level engines make room for those aft cargo bays. So again, that's a pretty good compromise when it actually comes to practicality. And that's almost where this whole thing comes together. There's been a lot of big changes to BFR. And you might go, why? Why is it every single year we see basically an entirely different rocket? How seriously can we actually start taking this stuff when every time we get a glimpse of it, it's totally different? Well, Elon actually said something extremely enlightening that gives us a really good perspective on some of the problem solving that goes into making a vehicle this groundbreaking.
But like this is a stupidly hard problem, and SpaceX engineering has, I think, done a great job with this design. It's like I don't think most people, even in the aerospace industry, like know what question to ask. Like it took us a long time to even frame the question correctly. But once we could frame the question correctly, the answer was, I wouldn't say easy, but the answer flowed once the question could be framed with precision. And framing that question with precision was very difficult.
Here's where we maybe got the biggest glimpse into SpaceX's design process for the BFR. SpaceX is doing something that almost no other aerospace company ever gets to do, and that's start with a completely blank canvas. Now, I'm not saying this has never been done before, but to not have some outside requirements that kind of gets in the way of your physics-led design is pretty unusual. You know, normally it's like we have this heritage hardware that we need to use or something, but in this case, SpaceX is starting from scratch, and they can let physics do the talking. Look at the space shuttle, for example. NASA had so many requirements from so many different people when they had to design that thing, it was really compromised. The Air Force said, we need the payload bay to be this big and be able to carry this much weight for our spy satellites. They also needed to be able to build the International Space Station with it and carry up to 8 astronauts. SpaceX doesn't have any of those outside requirements when designing this. So instead, SpaceX gets to first come up with a question of what does this actually need to do, and how do we make it do that the best? And this can lead to getting over some fears, like Elon's fear of wings, because wings are useless in space. Of course, he's right, you know, it's just dead mass when it's up there in space, but If they can scrub off a lot of velocity and save you a lot of delta V on reentry and landing, maybe they're worth considering. What we're witnessing is something incredibly unique. I can't think of any other company that's ever let you in on the design process. Can you imagine if Apple's like, hey, we're working on a new iPhone, we're gonna show you some tweaks along the way before it comes out? Or what if Lockheed Martin's like, hey, we're working on this new fighter jet, and every year we're gonna let you know what's changed in our design process before it comes out? That just wouldn't happen. So this is actually really exciting. We're watching the tweaking and the molding of a brand new rocket. It's a really cool demonstration of engineering. We're actually getting to see them tweak and tweak and tweak and make it better, which is what engineering is. You just often don't actually get to see it. So I guess the only real question I have remaining at this point is, will they be tweaking the BFR once they start making it? Kind of like they did with the Falcon 9. So SpaceX basically never made two Falcon 9s the same because they were constantly tweaking and adjusting it, making it better, and able to do things like, oh, I don't know, land, be, you know, recovered, and then reflown. It's something that's never been done before. Will they be tweaking the BFR constantly and making it better once they start? Well, I'm sure they will. It's SpaceX after all. And unfortunately, those are all the nitty-gritty details we got this time. Maybe we'll learn a little bit more when Elon does that Reddit AMA I asked for. You're welcome. How about as a return favor, let's all get on Twitter and ask Elon Musk to do a sit-down interview with me. I promise I'll ask all the good questions. While we're talking about favors, thanks to Tomorrow for letting me use their amazing studio space here. If you guys don't watch Tomorrow on YouTube, what are you doing? It's the best space show, period. That's youtube.com/TMRO. They film every Saturday live at 18 UTC, and you can join and have your comments in the show. They have interviews, they do up-to-date news. It's just the best. So make sure and go to youtube.com/TMRO. But of course, I owe the biggest and most sincere thank you to my Patreon supporters. If it wasn't for you guys, I wouldn't be able to come out here to California and cover things like this. I'm from Iowa, so getting out to California or down to Florida for launches is really expensive. And I owe you guys so much thank you for financially supporting me. If you want to help me continue to do things like this and get super nerdy about all the space stuff, please go to patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Seriously, thank you. It means the world to me. And while you're on the internet, check out my web store. It has lots of cool stuff like shirts and hats, mugs, prints of rocket launches, and lots of other fun, cool pictures. Check it out, everydayastronaut.com/shop. Oh, and thanks to my friend Patrick Lawler, who helped shoot this event with me. I mean, his stuff is just incredible. You should check it out. He's all over the internet. Thanks, everybody. That does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.